Good evening, everyone. Today's topic of discussion is primary angle closure disease. Me, myself, Dr. Pallavi Goel, and the topic is moderated by Dr. Sujata Vike. Before going into the details of primary angle closure disease, we'll go through the normal structure, that angle structure that we see on conioscopy. From posterior to anterior, we see iris root. That is the most, if we see the iris root, then the angle is open. Then scleral spur. Then we see pigmented posterior trabecular meshwork, anterior non-pigmented trabecular meshwork, and Scholbe's line. Classification of primary angle closure disease, as given by International Society of Geographic and Epidemiological Ophthalmology, is divided into primary angle closure suspect, primary angle closure, and primary angle closure glaucoma. Primary angle closure suspect is if there is there is more than 270 degree of iridotrabecular contact on gonioscopy that is done in a dark room with a 1 mm slit in primary gaze. There is no peripheral anterior synecchi, and the intraocular pressure is normal with disc, optic nerve, and visual fields showing no sign of any clinical glaucoma. At this stage, the angle is at risk. On gonioscopy, as we can see in this picture, without compression, in first picture we can see there is a iridotrabecular contact, and on compression the angle is opening up to the scleral spur. Next is primary angle closure. In primary angle closure, there is greater than 270 degree of iris trabecular contact. Approximately 75% of angle is involved. There is elevated intraocular pressure, or peripheral anterior synecchi can be seen, but the disc and visual fields are within the normal limits. At this stage, we can classify angle that as abnormal in structure and function. On gonioscopy, we can see that the angle structures are not visible, and on compression, there is still iridotrabecular contact. Next is primary angle closure glaucoma. In primary angle closure glaucoma, there is greater than 270 degree of iris trabecular contact with elevated intraocular pressure and peripheral anterior synecchi with associated optic disc damage corresponding to visual field abnormalities. At this stage, the angle is abnormal in structure and function with associated optic neuropathy.
Just 1 minute. For all practical purposes, 180 degrees. And second is, this definition, you don't require elevated IOP or PAS. You need to have iridotrabecular contact and disc or field damage.
Okay. We'll go through the burden of primary angle closure disease and associated blindness. Glaucoma is a leading cause of irreversible vision loss, both globally and in India. It has been estimated that more than 15 million people suffer from primary angle closure disease worldwide, and that is going to increase to 21 million by 2020, as stated by Quigley et al. Few studies that has been done in India are valorized survey that was done in the year 1993, where it showed the prevalence of primary angle closure glaucoma in urban city as 4.3%. In Andhra Pradesh eye disease study done between the period of 96 to 2000, in urban area, the prevalence of primary angle closure glaucoma was 1.8%. In Chennai glaucoma study done between 2001 to 2004, the prevalence of primary angle closure glaucoma in urban setup was 0.88%. Primary angle closure glaucoma is responsible for half of the blindness due to glaucoma. The blindness rate of angle closure glaucoma based on different studies are, according to Andhra Pradesh eye disease study, it is 16.6%. According to Chennai glaucoma study, in a rural setup it is 2.9%, and in a urban setup is 5.9%. Then risk of progression from a suspect to angle closure to primary angle closure glaucoma. It is stated by Thomas et al. Nearly one in four patients in primary angle closure suspect, 22% is likely to progress to primary angle closure over a period of 5 years. With the progression of primary angle closure to primary angle closure glaucoma being 28.6%. This risk of progression is higher in eyes which have bilateral primary angle closure or primary angle closure with a raised IOP. Because they use the different definition to diagnose the glaucoma, and the different definition for stating the disease as glaucoma, and they use different diagnostic tools for diagnosis of glaucoma. There should be a standard definition per se to define glaucoma in a population.
Factors that we get from the population study, the natural history of the disease, the course of the disease we can know. The risk of, like as she mentioned, risk of progression from PACS to PAC to PACG, that also we will know. So which patients we need to treat or not, we can find out.
So when you make a statement like that, you have to tell me what proportion of people with a shallow anterior chamber actually are not because of primary angle closure disease. You just have to read any of these studies, and you'll find the numbers there. Less than 1 in 30 people with a narrow angle are because of a secondary cause. The vast majority are because of a primary cause. So if you think that half the patients that you're seeing with narrow angles in the clinic are because of neovascular glaucoma and any other secondary clock, that's because you are not identifying primary angle closure appropriately. And this number that you have over there about PSCD, it's not PSCD, it's PSCG worldwide. PSCD, the numbers are more than 100 million.
Risk factors, they can be demographic factors and ocular factors. In demographic factor, age, mostly above the age of 40, the risk of primary angle closure disease increases. A lot of postulated theories are there. With increasing age, the lens thickness increases due to the cataractous changes, due to the pupillary meiosis, etc. Gender, females are more predisposed for angle closure disease than males. Since the women have a shallow anterior chamber, and 10% less volume compared to the male intraocular volume. Hereditary primary angle closure disease is sporadic, but it can be inherited as autosomal dominant or autosomal recessive pattern. Shallow anterior chamber and narrow angles as per se can commonly run in relatives. Then ocular risk factors are shallow anterior chamber, both periphery and centrally. Decreased anterior chamber volume, a short axial length of globe, small corneal diameter, anterior position of lens with respect to the ciliary body, increased curvature of anterior lens surface, a thick lens, and in hyperopic eyes. Genetics plays a role. Primary angle closure glaucoma is suspected to have a specific genetic risk based on its association with race, gender, and in families. Eskimos have a 3.5 times greater risk in first-degree relatives. In Southern and Sibling, there is a study done where there is more than 33% primary angle closure, and the siblings of those with primary angle closure or primary angle closure glaucoma patients have more than 10% risk of prevalence of PAC and PACG. Positive association has been seen with the CYPB1 gene. In a recent publication of about 10,000 PACG cases and 30,000 controls across Asia, Australia, North America, three loci were previously confirmed, and now five new genetic loci has been confirmed, as mentioned here. Pathogenesis of primary angle closure disease. Few mechanisms leading to primary angle closure glaucoma. These are basically divided on the level in which the mechanism is occurring. The angle closure originating at the level of iris, where we have a relative pupillary block, thick iris and its architecture. Angle closure originating at the level of ciliary body, like in plateau iris configuration, plateau iris syndrome, and pseudoplateau iris. Angle closure originating at the level of lens, where the lens can be enlarged or intumescent, or it can be dislocated anteriorly or subluxed. Angle closure originating posterior to the lens. These mechanisms are basically malignant glaucoma, or choroidal effusion and swelling of ciliary body, its rotation anteriorly and detachment, angle closure after scleral buccal procedures, angle closure after PRP, angle closure after retinal vein occlusions and posterior segment tumors. Then pupillary block glaucoma, the basic pathogenesis is in mid-dilate state, there occurs apposition and contact of lens and posterior iris surface. This leads to the blockage of circulation of aqueous humor from the posterior chamber to the anterior chamber, leading to increased pressure in posterior chamber, and hence the iris bows forward and comes in contact with the trabecular meshwork, leading to a angle closure. Initially, this can be a transient attack with apposition, but if prolonged attack or recurrent attack of contacts are there, it may lead to formation of peripheral anterior synecdoche with a permanent closure of trabecular meshwork. Next is plateau iris configuration and plateau iris syndrome. Plateau iris configuration, it is basically a narrow angle or angle closure in eye with a normal central anterior chamber depth on slit lamp examination. And the iris is flat, in a flatter plane from pupil to the periphery. It is basically diagnosed on gonioscopy and UBM. On gonioscopy, we can see iris appears flat, and it takes sharp turn posteriorly before inserting into the ciliary body, hence creating a narrow angle recess. The iris root is displaced anteriorly, and the peripheral iris shows a redundant or prominent role by iris insertion and giving a typical double hump or S sign. Ultrasound biomicroscopy. In a quadrant, it is defined by the presence of, there is irido angle touch, then there is anteriorly directed ciliary body, as you can see here. Then there is absence of ciliary sulcus, and the iris takes a sharp angulation from the corneoscleral wall. Plateau iris syndrome. Plateau iris syndrome is development of angle closure spontaneously or after pharmacological dilation in an eye with a patent iridotomy. Often seen in young patient, if it's not diagnosed or treated properly, the repeated episodes of angle closure can progress to a primary angle closure or primary angle closure glaucoma. It can be of two type according to Loy and Rich. It can be incomplete and complete. Basically, they find that in incomplete configuration, the ciliary body is not so anteriorly placed, so there is full closure of angle, and these patients does not land up in high IOP on pharmacological dilation. Then management of plateau iris syndrome, meiotic agent can be used to minimize the pupillary dilation, argon laser iridoplasty. If IOP is not controlled with medical therapy or argon laser iridoplasty, surgical managements such as trabeculectomy or other filtration surgery should be considered. While doing the surgery, care should be taken as these patients are at a very high risk of aqueous midriasis syndrome. Then management of primary angle closure disease. First, we'll go through the management of primary angle closure suspect. It is not needed to treat each and every primary angle closure suspect. On treatment, we can use medical treatment or peripheral laser iridotomy therapies. Basically, peripheral laser iridotomy therapy is needed in the patients in which the other eye is already having a primary angle closure or primary angle closure glaucoma or a one-eyed patient. if the repeated dilation is needed to the patient, like in diabetics and all, for posterior segment examination. If there is a very if there is a positive family history of primary angle closure glaucoma, if the patient is really is not able to be in a regular follow-up, or if there is difficult to reach the ophthalmic services. If we are not doing laser iridotomy, then we have to keep a patient in a close yearly follow-up with on every visit, we should go for IOP check and gonioscope. Management of primary angle closure. At this stage, the both structure, since there is formation of peripheral anterior synecdoche and functional damage with elevated IOP to the trabecular meshwork has happened. So we go, we do YAG laser iridotomy or iridoplasty. If after iridotomy, the angle opens up, but to a less than 180 degree, and the IOP is uncontrolled on medical treatment, we do a repeated gonioscopy and see the extent of pass. If the pass is less than 180 degree and the patient is having a visually significant cataract, then we go by phacoemulsification. If the peripheral anterior synecdoche is more than 180 degree and there is no cataract, then plain trabeculectomy is considered. If the patient is having a visually significant cataract, then phacotrab is considered. If the IOP is controlled on medical treatment, phacoemulsification can be tried for patients of having a visually significant cataract. If after iridotomy the angle opens for more than 180 degree, then we can keep the patient in close follow-up and go with periodic IOP check and gonioscopy. Then we'll rush through peripheral iridotomy. The basic purpose is to relieve a... If it opens up, then we do iridoplasty. If it opens up, then we need not to do iridoplasty. Peripheral iridotomy, its basic purpose is for relieving the pupillary block. Basically, we create our alternative path for aqueous to flow from posterior chamber to the anterior chamber, and hence the pressure in the posterior chamber is reduced. It is relatively non-invasive. The basic principle is photodestructive phenomena. Its indication is primary angle closure glaucoma, suspect primary angle closure in fellow eyes. 66 diopter Abraham contact lenses used. A crypt in the iris is selected, more commonly in a superior temporal quadrant. Basic parameter energy settings are 3 to 6 millijoules per shot. Spot size approximately of 50 micron. The endpoints that the PI is actually complete is gush of fluid and pigments from the posterior to the anterior segment. If we have done a lamellar PI, we can repose the procedure once the eye is quiet. Basically, after doing a PI, we should recheck the intraocular pressure after one hour to exclude any IOP spike and check the PI patency. Laser iridoplasty, the indication is if the angles are still occludable after laser iridectomy, it is to facilitate the access to trabecular meshwork after laser trabeculoplasty. Procedure, we use the Abraham lens, aim for a peripheral iris. We use the argon green laser. Then endpoint is iris stromal contraction with progressive peripheral anterior chamber deepening. And after laser to decrease the inflammation, we use topical steroid for a week. Patient is basically prepared with the, we use amniotic drops, pilocarpine, first week to constrict the pupil, and then we target so that the stretch on the iris comes, and we target the peripheral iris for the spots. Next is acute angle closure crisis. How to diagnose is, the basic symptoms are pain. It can be either ocular or periocular. Patient can complain of headache, nausea, or vomiting. IOP spike of more than 21 millimeter of mercury with a circumcorneal congestion. The corneal edema can be seen. Pupil can be mid-dilated because of the acute attack. There can be ischemia to the sphincter of pupil, a shallow anterior chamber. On slit lamp examination, we'll see a shallow anterior chamber based on the one hair excreting. We can see iris whirling due to the ischemic attack. Then on the lens, we can see glaucoma fleckens. That is due to the ischemia of anterior lens capsule in an acute attack. Sectoral iris atrophy can be seen. Management of acute angle closure. The immediate... Yes, ma'am, because in an acute attack, there will be ischemia due to the sudden IOP raise, and that leads to the glaucoma fleckens. Management of acute angle, primary acute angle closure. Immediate treatment should be focused at lowering intraocular pressure medically. We can use intravenous aqueous suppressants. We can use hyperosmotic agents like mannitol, a tablet of acetazolamine or glycerol syrup. Aqueous suppressant can be used to reduce the inflammation due to an acute attack. Steroids are used. In acute primary angle closure, anterior chamber periphery and the fellow eye with occludable angle, if we see, then we have to go with both eye peripheral iridotomy immediately. If we have to, before doing the laser peripheral iridotomy, we have to rule out any corneal edema. If excessive inflammation is there, we can medically manage and start the patient on a topical steroid and attempt the peripheral iridotomy again. If intraocular pressure is medically controlled and the cataract is visually significant, then we can go with phaco emulsification after the attack has been controlled. If the IOP is uncontrolled with medication and there is a peripheral anterior synecchi of less than 180 degree and the cataract is visually significant, we can go with phaco emulsification. And if IOP is uncontrolled and the peripheral anterior synecchi is more than 180 degree and there is no cataract, trabeculectomy is considered. In a eye with acute attack and more than 180 degree of peripheral anterior synecchi and visually significant cataract, phaco trap a combined procedure is. Role of argon laser iridoplasty in acute angle closure attack. Basically, argon laser iridoplasty mechanically pulls the peripheral iris away from the trabecular meshwork and hence help in lowering the intraocular pressure. Study by Lem et al., they stated that in the groups who had received argon laser iridoplasty just after after the acute attack of angle closure, their IOP levels were lower compared to the group who only had the medical treatment. Then a role of trabeculectomy post acute angle closure attack. Acute angle closure remains unresponsive to medical treatment if peripheral anterior synecchi is more than 180 degree. And the laser therapy cannot be taken because of hazy cornea and high level of inflammation. Then trabeculectomy may provide as an alternative solution. But it has been analyzed that post-operative complications are more in immediate TRAP patients. Hence, it may not be the best option post-attack. Then the role of clear lens extraction. Acute angle closure that is unresponsive to the conventional treatment due to excessive pars formation. Clear lens extraction can be considered, but Lam et al. Concluded that prevalence of IOP elevation after 18 months of following treatment was less in a phaco group than in a laser peripheral iridotomy group. The angle was significantly more open in a patient who underwent clear lens extraction compared to the laser peripheral iridectomy group. But the result of this study are not actually significant to be applied in our clinical practice. Primary angle closure glaucoma management. Then first step is to go for a laser iridotomy. Then put the patient on medical therapy. If after laser iridotomy the angle opens up to more than 180 degree, then we can keep the patient in close follow-up and a periodic gonioscopic visual field and IOP monitoring. If the angle opens to a less than 180 degree and the IOP is controlled by medical management, then if the patient is having associated visually significant cataract, then we can go for phacoemulsification. If the IOP is uncontrolled on medical management and the peripheral anterior senecae is less than 180 degree, then in case of cataract, then we will go for a combined procedure. And in case of absence of cataract, we can go for a trabeculectomy. If the peripheral anterior senecae is more than 180 degrees and the if the cataract is there, a combined procedure can be considered. And in the absence of cataract, plain trabeculectomy is considered. And some special fact for trabeculectomy in a primary angle closure glaucoma eyes. Preoperatively, we should be very considerate about a good preoperative IOP control. Perivaral block followed by a good ocular massage should be given. Intraoperatively, there should be slowed decompression of anterior chamber to avoid any post-op complication of malignant glaucoma. A AC maintainer with high molecular weight viscoelastic so that we can get a space of working during the surgery. Releasable sutures over scleral flap should be there to avoid shallowing of anterior chamber post-trap. A cycloplegic to maintain a deep anterior chamber should be used. Post-operatively, we should achieve a good pupillary dilation to avoid anterior chamber shallowing. Post-operatively, control of inflammation by using steroid antibiotics and midriatics should be considered. And facts to be considered for a plain cataract surgery in an angle closure eye. Preoperatively, there should be lowering of intraocular pressure to avoid any complication of suprachoroidal hemorrhage. Meiotics and prostaglandin analogs, as these are involved in the breakdown of a blood aqueous barrier, should be stopped. Retrobulbar block is best avoided because it leads to increase in intraocular pressure. Dilation on table should be considered to avoid precipitate any attack of angle closure. Intraoperatively, anterior chamber decompression should be done gradually, so that the choroidal vessels get a time to adapt to the new pressure. Otherwise, if sudden decompression is there, dilation of choroidal vasculature leads to the rupture of choroidal vessel and hence ultimately leading to suprachoroidal hemorrhage. High molecular weight viscoelastic to create operating space and protect endothelium and also aid for viscomidriasis. We can use soft cell technique where first we inject a visco dispersive agent for coating the endothelium and then followed by injecting a visco cohesive like Helon to maintain a deep anterior chamber so that we get a working place during operating. Intraoperative shallowing of anterior chamber should be best avoided with the help of adjusting the fluid dynamics and a proper bottle height. During hydrodissection, excessive fluid injection should be avoided because it may lead to infusion misdirection syndrome. What happens if we inject a lot of irrigation fluid, there is migration of fluid to the posterior chamber and hence leading to an intraoperative IOP spike. A good thorough removal of OVD from the anterior chamber and behind the IOL should be done to avoid any post-op intraocular pressure spikes. Post-operatively, the patient should be put on steroids to control inflammation and topical NSAIDs to prevent any post-operative cystoid macular edema. Uh, In the view of primary angle closure disease, a landmark study done is effectiveness of early lens extraction for the treatment of primary angle closure glaucoma, the EAGLE study. It was a randomized trial done over 30 hospitals, where 419 patients were enrolled, out of which 155 were primary angle closure and 263 were primary angle closure glaucoma. Of that, 208 underwent clear lens extraction and 211 underwent laser peripheral iridotomy with a medical therapy. The main outcome measures in the study were patient reported quality of health status, intraocular pressure, and cost effectiveness of the procedure after 36 months of follow-up. The result were mean health status score of 0.052 higher. The mean IOP was minus 1.18 mmHg lower after clear lens extraction compared to laser peripheral iridotomy and medical therapy. Azuel Blanco et al., they interpreted that clear lens extraction showed greater efficacy and was more cost effective than laser peripheral iridotomy and should be considered as a first option. But there are a few reasons why this study can't be extrapolated as a treatment of PAC of PACG. Because if we do a clear lens extraction in young patients, they lose their power of accommodation. In this study, the glaucoma extent that was taken was a very early glaucoma, which was much lower than the population we consider. Then gonioscopy finding were missing in 247. Approximately more than 50% of patients were not having the gonioscopic findings. And the difference of IOP between the two groups that were treated with clear lens extraction and the group that was medically and managed by LPI was very minimal. Few case scenarios. A 54-year-old female who came for regular ophthalmic checkup with a past history of diabetic mellitus since last 6 years. She's on tablet metformin, BD 500 mg. Family history is not contributory. Her best corrected visual acuity in right eye is 6x6N6 and left eye is 6x6N6. Her intraocular pressure taken by Goldsmann applanation tonometry at 9:15 a.m. is 16 mm of Hg in both eye, and the anterior chamber is quiet with von Herrick grade 1 in both eye. OU gonioscopy, and this we'll go for laser iridotomy in this patient because she's a known diabetic and repeated dilation for posterior segment examination will be needed. Case 2, a 43-year-old female with sudden onset pain, redness, and decrease in vision in her both eyes. Of 1 day, history elicited for 1 day duration. There is history of 5-6 episodes of vomiting. Medical history. She is hypertensive, controlled on medication. She has bronchial asthma on tablet Montelukast and other calcium and vitamin supplements. Headache for last 10 days with 1-2 such episodes per month. Diagnosed as migraine. She is on capsule topiramate and stopped 1 day prior to the onset of ocular symptoms. Elsewhere, she is treated as acute angle closure glaucoma. Her recollected baseline IOPs are 50 and 40 mm of Hg. Immediate treatment that was given was injection mannitol 200 cc IV, Redford eye drop 1 hourly, tablet acetazolamide 250 mg thrice a day, and tablet combiflin 1 SOS. She is continuously using the drops brimonidine thrice a day in both eye, pilocarpine 4 times a day in both eye, oral Grislot 30 ml thrice a day, tablet acetazolamide 250 mg thrice a day, and tablet combiflam SOS. Patient had no significant symptomatic relief. A 23-year-old woman with a gradual progressive diminution of vision in the left eye since last 1 year. It was associated with occasional headache. She was on topical intraocular pressure-lowering agents for past 5 months. The best corrected visual acuity in right eye was 6x18 and left eye was 6x24. IOP recorded with Goldsman applanation tonometry was 20 and 40 mm of HE. Slit lamp examination showed a shallow anterior chamber with a Von Harrocks grade 2 in both eyes. Gonioscopy revealed 360 degree of angle closure in both eyes.